Hi, I'm Ludwig. I'm working for SUSE in the Future Technologies team. And today we are looking at some potential future technology, which might be systemd boot. So first take a look, let's take a look at how booting used to work. So I painted an example with an EFI system nowadays. But the same method actually is on legacy. So the idea from the good old days was that you have some minimal code somewhere in the master boot record or whatever that then knows where the blocks for your Linux kernel are and loads the Linux kernel and its initrd to boot them. Those who remember Lilo was pretty annoying, you know, when you installed a new kernel and it was somewhere else on disk, then suddenly your system wouldn't boot anymore. So at some point, everyone switched to grub, which was amazing because suddenly grub would read the file system and you could put your kernel anywhere, it would still work and it wouldn't run into unbootable systems all the time. But times changed, we got new technologies, for example, disk encryption and BUTFS, and now every time we introduce a new technology, grub needs to have code to open this kind of volume. So grub needs to unlock the encrypted disk. Grub needs to be able to read kernel and initrd from a BUTFS snapshot. So grub was extended and extended over time. The advantage of this model, of course, is that each snapshot contains grub configs and the kernel, and everything kind of works naturally with the copy and write and yeah, how BUTFS snapshots works, but it makes the bootloader complicated. And at some point, EFI came along. Now the firmware can actually read a file system. The EFI system partition is a FAT file system, and the firmware will just read the bootloader from there, not just the bootloader, actually any PE binary. So what's actually possible is to read the kernel directly. So you could boot with a much simpler bootloader, and just have the bootloader to present a menu, and then tell the system to read the kernel initrd directly. And then the kernel can take care of unlocking the encrypted volume. You don't have to implement that in the bootloader anymore. So the advantage of this model is that you end up with a much simpler architecture. The bootloader doesn't have to have all this code for unlocking weird file systems or disk encryptions or password derivation functions that change over time. So you wouldn't need to play all this catch-up all the time that Linux user space already implemented. And the end is also less maintenance, because you need to maintain the bootloader. There's bugs. You have it in stable distributions where you need to backport features. So it's desirable to have a simpler architecture. And a bootloader that actually implements a simple architecture with this idea from the start is systemd boot. So it's a rather basic UEFI-only bootloader. It does not contain any file system drivers. It cannot open LUX volumes. So none of that code is in there. It basically reads some text files and presents a menu. And another feature that it has is that it can actually auto-discover PE binaries on the EFI system partition, so it doesn't even need configuration files. Systemd boot also integrates very well with systemd. So you have commands that analyze your boot time, for example, and systemd boot provides features for systemd to measure the timing also in the bootloader. It also has convenience features, so you can right away say system control reboot and a specific menu entry, and it would automatically reboot into this different kernel, for example. So you don't need this special grub once or whatever. It's directly integrated. And what systemd boot also offers is boot assessment. So it has a countdown entries, or potentially has a countdown entries. And when the system booted successfully in such an entry, it would bless the boot and then reuse it the next time. Or if it fails, just reboot and boot some previous version that is already built into the bootloader in a rather simple way. So let's take a look at the config files of systemd boot. The one way is simple text files in the EFI system partition. Usually you name them with the machine ID and the version of the kernel. The machine ID is there to be able to have parallel installations of different operating systems, either from the same vendor or from different vendors. That way there's no competing over who has the main config files. You just drop yours, and whatever bootloader, whatever version of system debooters in the ESP would show all of them. That also means you need to put kernel innerd in some machine ID or somehow installation specific directory. By default, it's slash machine ID and then the kernel version. So here I have an example of an actual config file. As you can see, it is pretty simple. No huge thing. It's just some title for the menu, some kernel version, maybe some hints for the bootloader how to sort entries. Then you have the machine ID, so it knows which operating system or which entries belong together for installation. You can specify the kernel command line, obviously, and kernel innerd. So the other way that systemdboot can find entries is so-called UKIs, unified kernel images. That one works without config files. So UKI is a kernel and an innerd concatenated, and some systemd stub is prepended to that. So all of this thing is one PE binary. This thing can be built on server side, like in OBS, and signed. So you could, with secure boot, you could directly load this, and the kernel and innerd would be verified together. And systemd invented some method to also load extensions, because the innerd that way would be quite static, and you may need system-specific drivers, so there's actually a way to load extensions into this image and also have them signed. In order for systemd boot to find those UKIs, they need to be put in slash EFI Linux on the EFI system partition. And then the PE binary actually contains the nice title and also the kernel command line to use for this one. And that is actually the preferred solution of upstream nowadays. For us right now, it's a bit of a problem because the kernel command line is within the signed image, and we need to specify the butterfs snapshot to boot. That is not something that we know in advance. So right now we can't use them. Upstream is currently discussing solutions how to have ways to specify kernel command line outside of this signed image in a still safe way. But let's see. For now, for my prototyping, I concentrated on the text file configuration. So what are the challenges there? First of all, the EFI system partition is FAT, like a very basic file system. So you don't have snapshots and you don't have copy and write. Now, if we create snapshots, and those snapshots could have a new kernel or not, they have maybe different kernel models or not. So you may need different innerds. And with butterfs, or like with grub reading butterfs, you have that naturally. Now, we somehow need to map this in a FAT file system and track which kernel, which innerd belongs to which snapshot. All of this is outside of the scope of RPM, so you can't just package files in slash boot EFI, because then if you uninstall a package, RPM would remove the file from the EFI partition while it could be still in use by some other snapshot. So no packaging of any files in boot EFI means we somehow need to copy the kernel from user into the EFI system partition and then create a configuration file that tells the kernel which snapshot it belongs to. And for uninstalling, we need a way to do some ref counting. So instead of just removing the kernel, we first need to check, are there still config files that use it, and only remove the kernel or the innerd once no config refers to it anymore. What are the ways to do that? So we can have scripted, just like now, the kernel calls into grub and grub creates a config. Now we can call some other script that copies the kernel into EFI system partition. And we need to put a checksum on the kernel. So we make sure that if for whatever reason the kernel got rebuilt in factory, we still have a different file on the EFI partition. And the same for the innerd. Whenever Draycut creates an entity, we can't just call it entity, but need to somehow make sure that it has some unique bits in the file name, so it can be associated to a specific snapshot. And to make it work, not just when installing packages, but also when you create snapshots manually with Snapper or with transactional update, we also need hook scripts into Snapper. So whenever Snapper creates a snapshot, it would need to check, is there a new kernel in this snapshot? Is it already an ESP? Is there already a config file? And create it if needed. And when deleting a snapshot, the same. Needs to look at the other kernels that are in other snapshots, remove them if needed. Those hook scripts need to be different between a transactional system and a traditional read-write system. Because in a traditional system, you would do that post-snapshot creation. Like the snapshot is created, then you look at the snapshot and call your scripts. With a transactional system, the snapshot is first created, then modifications are created, applied to the snapshot. And only after that is done, we need to look at the snapshot and potentially copy it to the ESP. So I created a prototype to see how we can actually do that. The status of that is available. So you can actually check the build service. There's a MicroS image with systemd boot in it. It does have handling of snapshots. So the snapper was extended to actually properly call hooks. I've implemented this reference counting in boot control. So you can now say boot control unlink some config file and would do exactly this checking. Then I tried to look at the kernel install script that comes with it, systemd, to do the copying of the kernel into the ESP and creating the config files and stuff. But after several iterations, I basically gave up because it just gets too complicated to get some results in a reasonable time. So I wrote a separate script to do exactly that and only that. Similar situation with boot control. So for us, it's not sufficient to just install systemd boot into the ESP, but we also need shim, because if you want to boot that on a actual physical hardware on a normal PC, you need secure boot, and then you need shim. So getting the code in shape for that is also quite tricky, because we need to do all of that in alignment with upstream. So I postponed this for now, and the reuse the script I also use for kernel install for installing systemd boot. What's currently in the works is getting rid of grub. So there's quite some places where we have, for example, patterns requiring grub or Kiwi images requiring grub. I'm currently working on removing those. There's also a Yast support work in progress, so that is done by Shubi. So at some point, we should have Yast offering systemd boot. What's currently not worked on but needs to is updating systemd boot itself in the ESP. I don't even know how it's done with grub right now. I think it's just copied at random times. And with systemd boot, we should be a bit smarter to maybe also be able to roll back the bootloader itself. A big challenge with the ESP is the space situation. So at any point in time, we could run out of space, actually. And so far, all the hook scripts, the RPM post scriptlets, they can't deal with this situation. But to move this into production, we need to solve this. Then we may want to actually switch to pre-built initIDs. That makes life easier in quite some ways and speeds up the thing. Because right now we have to call Draycut all the time, and that takes time just to figure out that maybe nothing changed and then throw it away again. What's also in the to-do list is the boot assessment. Right now, MicroS uses a health checker, but upstream has this BlessBoot framework, and I think we should hook into that instead. And upstream is actually open to discussing a unified solution there. So if anyone is interested in health checker and getting that upstream, integration with boot time assessment is needed. And of course, whatever we do should be in factory. So factory first, upstream first. I have no intentions to create some SUSE-specific solution. Even the script that I wrote for installing, I think it's meant to be thrown away. I would really prefer to have some way to properly integrate with boot control and kernel install maybe, or find a successor of kernel install that suits our needs. So the elephant in the room, of course, is what about non-UEFI? So far we only talked about UEFI. And I think there's different ways to handle that. One would be a UEFI emulation layer, like it's done on ARM with Grub already. So there's U-Boot that just emulates a UEFI firmware, and then you can boot the regular EFI-based binary. That probably also works with systemd, systemd boot, even on x86 maybe. So you could have a UEFI emulation on x86. But maybe that is too complicated. So another solution would be actually to use Grub instead of systemd boot, but with the systemd boot architecture. So I think that is one of the main things to keep in mind when we're talking about systemd boot. It does not necessarily have to be the exact systemd boot binary, but we could also just use the config file format, the locations, all the scripting that we need for systemd boot anyway, and then use Grub, but without the file system drivers and all the fancy features, because all that Grub needs to do is somehow read this FAT partition that contains the bootloader config. Of course, the same would work with any other bootloader that somehow reads the bootloader specification. So I'm not familiar with the more exotic architectures, but if they can somehow read a text file, then they could probably boot a system like this. And as I said before, one of the main points is that the bootloader does not have to read fancy file systems or LUX volumes, so it should be really easy to implement that on a different architecture. Yeah, so we could, and it, with all this preparation, where we call some hooks that copy stuff to the ESP and prepare this bootloader specification style stuff in the ESP, we could, of course, also just not use those hooks and just use the infrastructure that we created for this and do something entirely different. So if some architecture, for whatever reason, doesn't want this specific config file format, then they can also implement something else, because now suddenly Grub is no longer hard-coded, and you can do whatever you want to get your kernel somewhere where it can be booted by this architecture-specific thing. So some links. First one is in the build service. This is my proof of concept, a microS-based system with systemd boot in it. It's heavily in the works. So right now I'm in the process of switching to the script that I mentioned. So use at your own risk. But it's worth a try to see how all that fits together. Then, of course, the bootloader specification. So whatever systemd boot does is not just written code, but they actually wrote a document that explains how it's configured. And last but not least, I have a progress OpenSUSE.org list of open tasks that should be implemented. So if you're interested in jumping into the topic or just want to follow the progress, then feel free to look at progress.opensuse.org. Nothing secret about that. Yeah, and that's it basically already from my side. Now, your turn. Questions? Jan?
So I think that two-stage bootloaders are actually here to stay. I'm thinking back to the days when Sun workstations were a thing, and they did exactly that. So the firmware read a UFS file system and just leached the kernel off that. But then, like 20 years later, people realized, oh, the firmware has some kind of limitation, like. In some case, it was that, for example, you could only load 10 megabytes from network before the thing just gave up. And so just relying on firmware, it will probably not work all the time.
Maybe. I mean, even the, especially the UEFI firmware has bugs. So actually, the very fact that we need a bootloader on UEFI is already weird, because the point of UEFI was that you can have multiple bootloaders and you have those entries, and still we need to put a bootloader. That's because of limitations of the firmware. But nevertheless, all those fancy features are already in the Linux kernel, so if we go for rich bootloaders, we have to play catch up. So that's why I think it makes sense again to revisit this idea to have the bootloader smaller, simpler, and try to get the Linux kernel running as soon as possible.
Hi, my question is similar. With the UKI images, why do we need a bootloader at all? I mean, that's already answered.
Yeah, exactly, because of firmware limitations.
So, coming from the extreme other end, if you want to have full measured secure boot, you'd probably go with a signed kernel, signed initrd. If you map this to the systemd example, is there anything missing, or where we have to be careful to not, for example, from the running system, mess with the UEFI partition?
I mean, all of systemd boot and the UKIs is designed with secure boot in mind. So that's what Upstream has in mind. That's their goal. And you can't screw up other than rendering the system unbootable. So if you modify something that is signed, system won't boot with that anymore. Yeah, so I mean, full disk encryption is a main motivation for this thing here. And secure boot, and also measuring it. Yeah. So I don't think there's an issue but from our side.
In to-do, you mentioned graceful handling of no space left on partition. First of all, my understanding is that this problem is generic. It's not about systemd boot. It's same for other environments, right? Or there is some spike in this problem. And second, like general solutions, from what I know now, it's only a service which clean up old kernels, and that's it. What else can be done with this? What may be the ideas?
First question. Yes, of course, you always can run out of space, but in the way it's currently done, it's actually a root file system. So the RPM installation would probably fail. Is your root file system. But with EFI, you introduce another file system that has a fixed size, so then you can run out of space on your root partition and on the EFI partition. And on top of that, the EFI partition is quite small nowadays, so there's a limited amount of snapshots that we can put there today. So it needs to be taken into consideration. That the ESP may run off out of space sooner than the root file system. And I didn't quite get the second question. Can I repeat it?
What actually, do you have any ideas how it can be gracefully handled? Because I just cannot imagine what you can do. So you run out of space, and then what? You start deleting files, but you don't know what you can delete and what you cannot. And
the solution to that is using transactional systems. In the future only, and then the transaction must fail if it can't make the new snapshot bootable.
So basically just it's not handling the situation, but correctly roll back.
If you can't make the transaction bootable, then you need to throw away the transaction and pretend it never happened.
Okay, thank you.
More questions? No? 3, 2, 1. Then we're done.